Echo and Harper Audio present Everybody Thought We Were Crazy, Dennis Hopper, Brooke Hayward, and 1960s Los Angeles by Mark Rozzo. Read by Jason Culp. For Valeria and Ines and Cecilia. A note before we begin. For notes on the text and a selected bibliography, don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider or go directly to harpercollins.com/pages/ Everybody Thought We Were Crazy. And love comes in at the eye. That's all we shall know for truth before we grow old and die. William Butler Yeats, A Drinking Song. Live not for others, but affect thyself from thy enhanced interior, believing what thou carry. Michael McClure, Ghost Tantra 49. Prologue. Los Angeles, November 6, 1961. In the fall of 1961, Brooke Hayward was coming down with a case of what she called the transcontinental blues. The air of Los Angeles turned brittle as the humidity level descended towards zero. The Santa Ana winds were rasping and harsh. A drought made the Santa Monica Mountains and Bel Air Canyons tinder dry. It was the season, as Joan Didion would later write, of suicide and divorce and prickly dread. Pleased though she was about her recent shoot for Life magazine and her first appearance in a feature film, Mad Dog Cole, Brooke felt like an exile. I miss the seasons, New York City, my apartment overlooking the planetarium, the theater, museums, friends, she recalled. In particular, she missed her father, who loathed L.A. almost as much as he loathed his daughter's new husband. He was enraged by the couple's move to the West Coast, just as he'd been by their hasty wedding in New York 3 months before. The tense emotional detente between father and daughter would endure for years. Brooke also missed her little sister. October 18th marked a full year since her death. Now the second anniversary of the death of her mother was approaching too. It was just around Halloween that her new husband vanished. Brooke called all over town, but no one had seen him, or if they had, they weren't telling. On the topic of marriage, he had once said, "I won't be easy to live with. I go off on strange tangents. Why, I might not even come home for 3 days." 3 days stretched to a week, and there was still no sign of him. It pained Brooke, sitting in their little rental house at the top of Stone Canyon Road in Bel Air, to admit to herself that her father had been right. This man was pure trouble. She decided to move back to New York with Jeffrey and Willie, her toddler sons from her first marriage, and write this second marriage off. It was a disaster. Her missing husband was Dennis Hopper, a fellow actor who had become a teenage movie star in the 1950s after he had appeared in Rebel Without a Cause and Giant. Dennis had a reputation for waywardness, and Brooke never would solve the mystery of his whereabouts that week. But one hot night in early November, under a moonless sky and with the Santa Anas whipping through the eucalyptus trees, Dennis slipped back into the house and got into bed next to Brooke. She pretended not to notice. She'd let him have it in the morning. Brooke never had the chance. That Monday morning, November 6th, a fire reared up in a patch of resinous brush north of Mulholland Drive. Driven by 50-mile-an-hour gusts, the flames refused to be contained. Brooke was readying the boys for school when she saw a pair of fire trucks racing up Stone Canyon Road. While her husband slept, she watched the man across the street run out of his house and stand there, looking up toward Mulholland Drive through binoculars. He started loading his station wagon. Brooke shook Dennis awake. He opened his eyes to find a scene that was already tipping toward chaos. She, "I'll come back and get you." He, "We gotta save something." Brooke hurried Jeffrey and Willie into the car for their daily ride to the John Thomas Dye School on Chelan Road. They would be safer there. Dennis grabbed a Milton Avery painting, a reclining nude that had belonged to Brooke's parents, off a wall, and as Brooke was about to pull out of the drive, threw it into the car. "I thought he was nuts," Brooke remembered. There was no time to save the Chinese tapestries that Dennis's father had given them, or the books, or the photo albums, or the toys. What ensued was a day of surreal hell scenes, as the Bel Air fire came roaring down the canyon roads, Stradella, Roscommere, Stone Canyon, on its way to consuming more than 6,000 acres in the most destructive conflagration in the region's history. Burning shingles lofted through the air, picture windows crumbled, and carbonized patio furniture floated in swimming pools. Low-flying B-17s buzzed overhead in a rust-orange sky, dropping borate solution. Nearly every fire department in the city was dispatched to Bel Air as the flames climbed 50 feet and the fire jumped from house to house, from road to road, from canyon to canyon. It swept across Bel Air and Brentwood, incinerating everything in its path at a rate of 13 acres per minute, reaching as far west as Topanga Canyon. The fire department's official report described it as a hurricane of fire. The family's accounts of that traumatic morning are a Gordian knot of conflicting recollections, oft-told stories, and smeared impressions formed amid the chaos that was building on Stone Canyon Road. In the course of the day, Brooke drove through corridors of flame to retrieve the boys and return to Stone Canyon, while Dennis set out on foot, pulling obstinate neighbors out of their burning houses as he made his way down the hill toward Sunset Boulevard. When Brooke made it back to Stone Canyon, she found the scorched street closed to traffic. Her husband was nowhere in sight. In Nathaniel West's novel, The Day of the Locust, a painter toils day and night on an apocalyptic canvas called The Burning of Los Angeles. The Bel Air fire made that cataclysmic vision real. It was responsible for the most devastating property losses in California since the 1906 San Francisco earthquake. And it was responsible for the destruction of Brooke and Dennis's house at the top of Stone Canyon, among the first of nearly 500 houses to burn that day. If you were a believer in omens, it was not the most auspicious beginning for a marriage. But Brooke Hayward and Dennis Hopper, one an ingenue on the upswing and the other a self-sabotaging hard case, were soon to become, as one chronicler noted, the coolest kids in Hollywood. Theirs was destined to be the emblematic love story of 1960s Los Angeles, that golden epoch of post-war California at its sunny apex. They were the prime catalysts and connectors during a brief, kaleidoscopic cultural moment when Hollywood upstarts, art world superstars, and the emerging shaggy aristocracy of rock rubbed up against one another and threw off sparks. The concurrent revolutionary ferment in art, music, and movies made the city of Los Angeles, so often dismissed as a frontier backwater, into a cultural force. Brooke and Dennis, more than anyone else, connected those realms. "It was a great time to be in Los Angeles," Brooke said. No more transcontinental blues. Beginning anew after the Bel Air fire, the household they created on North Crescent Heights Boulevard, a sinuous byway in the Hollywood Hills above the Sunset Strip, became the repository of one of the era's greatest private collections of contemporary art. Lichtensteins and Warhols, Stellas and Ruchers, Rauschenbergs and Kienholzes, even one of the last pieces that Marcel Duchamp, the 20th century's provocateur-in-chief, would ever create. The house was an art piece itself, the so-called Prado of Pop, in which Brooke's design experiments and Dennis's eye for paintings, sculptures, and assemblages created an environment that left an indelible mark on everyone who stepped into it. Jane Fonda, Brooke's best friend growing up, called it a magical house. For Joan Didion, it was a place of such gaiety and wit that it seems the result of some marvelous scavenger hunt. Andy Warhol loved it and compared it to an amusement park. when Michael Nesmith, a guitar-picking cast member on The Monkees, talked about his memory of the Hayward Hopper house, he was emphatic. "It was a tattoo," he said. "I mean, it just burned into my mind." Irving Blum, the impresario of the Ferris Gallery, the epicenter of LA's emergent art scene, said of the trail the couple blazed, "They were virtually unique, you know? There was nobody else doing it in the way that they were doing it." The house at 1712 North Crescent Heights became the era's unofficial living room. Brooke and Dennis helped introduce Warhol to the West Coast with a spectacular coming-out party, hosted Jasper Johns and Klaus Oldenburg, entertained an entire Olympus of movie gods, and gave shelter to Hell's Angels and Black Panthers. They befriended the futuristic fashion visionary Rudy Gernreich and his model muses, along with the musicians who were the avatars of the day, the Byrds, Ike and Tina Turner, Jefferson Airplane, Brian Jones. They hung out with writers such as Didion, Terry Southern, and Michael McClure, and were among the new Hollywood generation of the Fondas and Jack Nicholson. Like Gerald and Sarah Murphy, the lost generation expat couple who inspired F. Scott Fitzgerald's Tender is the Night, Brooke and Dennis knew everyone, hosted everyone, ran a free-flowing salon, and transformed everyday life into the stuff of art. They made all those around them feel as though their lives were touched with art, too. During their 8 years of marriage, Brooke and Dennis embodied the collision of old Hollywood and new, of chic bohemia and the burgeoning counterculture. They were as implausible a couple as ever existed. She was a Hollywood royal, the debutante daughter of the agent and producer Leland Hayward and the actress Margaret Sullivan, from whom Brooke had inherited a trademark steeliness and pinpoint wit. The young Brooke had been no princess. She was eccentric and rebellious and yearned to make a name as a writer or artist. Her upbringing had been peripatetic, bicoastal, and tumultuous, punctuated by the broken marriage of her brilliant, distracted parents. Dennis came from Dodge City, Kansas, by way of the San Diego suburbs, incandescently talented and hell-bent on saturating his life with creativity, from the inner sanctums of Hollywood studios to the outer fringes of the avant-garde. He had looks, imagination, acting skills honed on Shakespeare, and a boiling, fervid energy. By the late 1950s, he'd been jettisoned from the upper reaches of the movie business for being an all-around pain in the neck. And so, thanks to a Nikon that Brooke bought him in 1961, Dennis became a photographer. He documented the civil rights marches in Alabama, the Sunset Strip riots, the human bee-in. He shot gallery announcements, album covers, and images for Art Forum and Vogue. He photographed artists, actors, writers, rock stars, and daily life at 1712 with Brooke and their children, leaving behind a vast visual archive of the decade, around 18,000 images, that was, for years, all but forsaken and forgotten. Dennis thought his photographs represented failure, yet he also surmised that they might, in time, be seen as his lasting legacy, more so than acting or directing. His double standard, a cacophonous streetscape shot through the windshield of a Corvair convertible stopped at a red light, is in the Museum of Modern Art. It is one of the most remarkable visual evocations of Los Angeles ever created. Brooke found a rich aesthetic outlet of her own, turning 1712 into a veritable design laboratory. Dennis marveled at her DIY gumption as she rolled up her sleeves and got to work painting, tiling, and raiding LA's antiques emporia, galleries, and junk shops for cast-off treasures. As omnivorous as Dennis was with his Nikon, so was Brooke as she hunted down a mad profusion of visual stimuli, from Belle Epoque advertising posters to turn-of-the-century street lamps. It was old and new, high and low. It was young and witty and camp when camp was barely a thing. Inside the stage set of 1712 North Crescent Heights, the drama of an entire era would play out, the artistic upheaval, the social jumble, the radical politics, and ultimately the instability and danger that Dennis reflected in the movie that made his career and blew this inspired, combustible union apart. The decade had ignited Dennis and Brooke's love and imaginations. There were new opportunities and new dangers. The counterculture beckoned, but so did three children, one of their own and two from Brooke's first marriage. How to reconcile freedom and responsibility, adventure and domesticity? The push-pull between macho outlaw energy and nascent feminism was relentless. Amid accelerating weirdness, the mood inside 1712 darkened. Dennis lost himself in drink, flew into rages, brought guns into the house. By the late 60s, Brooke or Dennis might stand at the kitchen sink of their pop art house, surrounded by Lichtensteins and 19th century French illustrations, and look out the wide window into a backyard full of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.